This is chapter number 5, Popular Struggles and Movements. Pressure groups and movements. So pressure groups, as the name suggests, the groups, that is group of people who are there to apply pressure. Pressure on whom? Pressure on the administration, pressure on the government. So these pressure groups are organization. Please understand, they are organizations, they are sanghathan that attempt to influence government policies. But unlike political parties, these pressure groups, they do not aim to directly control or share political power. That is, they are not made to gain any political power. They don't want to be ministers or in cabinet. Right? They just want their demands to be met, whatever they have. So these organizations are formed when people with common occupation, say doctors, lawyers, with same interests, aspirations, opinions, akankshaye, ichchaye, come together in order to achieve a common objective. So they all have common objective, and that is why these pressure groups are being formed. Now, what we see in Nepal, we have discussed about Nepal, so that the people who came on the street, that was not pressure group, but it was called as a movement for democracy. So when we talk about people movement to describe many forms of collective actions, that is the Narmada Bachao Andolan, the movement for right to information, RTI, that is why we got this RTI Act in 2005. Then the anti-liquor movement. The anti-liquor movement in Bihar, when the women, they started a movement. After that, Bihar is now a liquor-free state. And women movement, these are all the movement, environmental movement. So like an interest group, a movement also attempts to influence politics. So the pressure groups also and movements also, they both have the same agenda. They want to influence the politics. They want to influence the government policies. So they are not taking any part in the electoral competition, unlike the political parties. But unlike these groups, these movements, as we see this Chipko Andolan and other Andolan we just talked about, Narmada Bachao Andolan, they don't have that formal structure. They are quite flexible. So what happened that if government came up with the CAA, that is Citizenship Amendment Act, so a lot of people came on to the street, Hindu, Muslims, Sikhs, etc. Because they thought that if they don't come on the streets, there will be a problem when the NRC will come and the NPR will come, etc. So this is how the people, because of some, stimulus, they came on the street. So that is why it's not so formal. It's quite informal. Let me show you some these pressure groups like the Amnesty International, Greenpeace, Shelter. These are the examples of proper pressure groups. So social sectional interest groups and public interest groups. So we need to differentiate between these two. Trade unions, business associations, professionals, for example, lawyer, doctors, teachers. These are some example of a particular section interest group. Usually this interest group seeks to promote the interest of a particular section. That is for trade union, mazdoors, for laborers, for lawyers. So they are only interested in a particular section or a group of society. They are not interested in everyone. Their principal concern or idea is the betterment or upliftment or well-being of their members, but not the society in general. This is the sectional interest group. Sometimes these organizations are not about representing the interest of one section of the society. So there are certain organizations, we are talking about this public interest group now, they are certain organization, they represent some common or general interests that needs to be defined. So this second type of groups are called as promotional groups or public interest groups. So there is a difference. Sectional interest group are only interested in their sadasya, their members, upliftment of their sadasya. But public interest groups, they are interested in their upliftment also, and also the others. That is, their aim is to help groups other than their own members. That is, the basic is to help their members. But if other groups also want their help, they are there. I'll tell you an example of FEDECOR. FEDECOR, this is a Bolivian organization, is an example of an organization which started this water, there was a water problem, you know, there was a water war. In the Nepal, we found the participation of human rights organization. When we talk about this second type, then we can give an example. This FEDECOR was, you know, meant for certain specific issues, specific community. But when we talk about the second type, then we talk about those people who are working for the Bandhua Mazduri. That is, the bonded labor. So these groups fight against bonded labor. Not they are not fighting for themselves, but for the people who are suffering under this bondage. We have other groups of this type, like public interest groups. For example, BAMSEF. The BAMSEF is a government employees union. That is, BAMSEF, Backward and Minorities Community Employees Federation, BAMSEF. This is BAMSEF. So this is an organization largely made up of government employees only that campaign against caste discrimination, SC, ST, OBCs. But the whole idea is the benefit of or the addressing of problems of its member from who are suffering discrimination. But along with that, they are interested in, or they work for, they have concern for the social justice and social equality also. And not for themselves or their members, but for the entire society. So this is the difference between social sectional interest groups who are only interested in their group, their people, and public interest group who are interested in their people as well as every other. Now coming to the movement groups, Andolan Samuh. As in the case of interest group, we saw the group involved with movements also include a wide variety. So interest group has a lot of variety. Here also movements also has a wider variety. So most of the movements are issue specific movement that seek to achieve single objective and also in a limited time frame. That is, if this is, say, they want it in 1 month, so this is the time frame, and they have a single objective, like the Narmada Bachao Andolan. It is specifically meant for one specific issue. So this Narmada Bachao Andolan, this started with a specific issue of the people displaced by the creation of Sardar Sarovar Dam Bandh on Narmada River in Gujarat. So the objective was to stop the dam from being constructed, and after the dam was constructed, the problem was the compensation of the people who have suffered the displacement and all those suffrage which comes after making a dam. So these single issue movement can be contrasted with the movements that are long terms. So there are various movements. So a movement can be long term also, and it can be short term also. Narmada Bachao Andolan, as we just said, it is a movement. So because of the Sardar Sarovar Dam, it started, and for the one issue it started, but it became a wider movement. That is, it actually became a large, long-term movement that questioned that all the big dams which the government is planning or has planned, what is the model of development that required such dam? That is, the aftermath of making a dam is really dangerous. So movements of this kind tend to have a clear leadership. For example, in the Narmada Bachao Andolan, we have Medha Patkarji. She is a clear leader of them and some organizations, but their effective life is usually short. But in this case, this is still going on. Let me take an example of environment or Mahila Andolan. So environmental movement is labeled for a large number of organizations, and it is a issue specific movement. It is the Paryavaran movement or environmental movement is only for environment, like saving trees, like saving the animals, saving the birds, flora and fauna. So these are issue specific movements, and there are large number. One movement is this one, the other one is this one. So there is an umbrella, you can say. The thing is that when you talk about a Paryavaran movement or environmental movement, they all have one specific thing in mind. That is, they have clear objective. That is, they want to save the environment. And that is why they are called as movement, because they, maybe the leaderships are different, people or the groups are different, but they have the same objective. So we have an umbrella movement. We can have umbrella movement. That is the, this is called an umbrella movement, inside which or under this umbrella, we have various movements, say movement 1, movement 2, movement 3. For example, we have this NAPM. NAPM stands for National Alliance of People's Movement. So this is an organization of organizations. So here is an organization which consists of various organizations. So various movement groups struggling on various specific issues. These are part, constituents of this loose organization that is called NAPM. So now the question comes that how does this pressure groups and these movements, they actually pressurize the government, or how do they influence politics? Because the main idea, key idea of making a pressure group or movement is that only. So first is they try to gain public support and sympathy for their goals and their activity to carrying out information. That is, how do they do it? They do campaigns, they organize meetings, they file petition, and they also try to influence the media. Media means the newspapers, the TV channels, and other medias. They are this, today we have social media also. So they try to influence these, they try to call them and show them that what they are doing, so that their voice may be heard. If you see here, she is Medha Patkar. And as I said, that there are certain organizations which are umbrella organization under which we have various organizations. Now, the second way how these pressure groups and movement exert influence is they often organize protest activity like strikes and disrupting the government programs. Because if they are disrupting something else, nobody is going to listen to them. Government is not going to listen to them. So if they stop the train, if they stop the buses, then the government will be, you can say, it will be pressurized to listen to their demands. Then there are business groups, big business groups, like the Ambanis, Adanis, the Tatas and Birlas. So they often employ professional lobbyists or sponsors, or they can have a sponsor expensive advertisement. Now, how does this happen? Can you imagine Ambani going to the Prime Minister or the Cabinet and asking for something? No. Ambani will hire, because he has, you know, he is the richest man of India. So he will hire some lobbyist, and these people will go to the government and they will ask for the favor in whatever way, because the Ambani is providing a lot of, you can say, a lot of this rozgar employment, and also it is giving the boost to the economy. So now the lobbyists are there who on the account of or for the favor of these industrialists and big people, these lobbies, they ask for the favor. In certain instances, the pressure group are either formed or led by the leaders of political parties, or they act as extended arms of political parties. For example, there are certain political parties. I'll just come to this, but there is one more thing before I go to this point. Political stance, there are various groups, these movements and groups, or the, you can say, the pressure groups, they take a stand on certain issue. They have political ideology and political position in various major issues. This is very important. Now, coming to this point, which I said that political parties have a hand above, or you can say they are favoring various groups. For example, almost all the trade unions, all these student unions, all these organizations, they are either established by the political parties, or they are wing of the established wing of these political parties, or they are affiliated to the political parties. For example, NSUI. NSUI is you can say student wing of Indian National Congress. Then ABVP. This is the student wing of Bharatiya Janata Party. So that is how this most of the pressure groups generally we see in the school, colleges, the universities, and in the offices like trade unions, they are subjected to, they are affiliated to these political parties. Sometimes we have seen that the political parties grow out of a movement. So if some movement is going on, for example, take this example. Now this is Assam Gana Parishad. Assam Gana Parishad, how was it formed? These were students. They started agitation, they started the movement to stop the foreigners, illegal immigrants coming to Assam. When this movement ended, then these people, these students, they formed a party, Assam Gana Parishad. And when the election happened, this Assam Gana Parishad, they won the elections. So this is how they made this Assam Gana Parishad. This came out of movement. If you talk about DMK or AIDMK, these parties also came out of the movement that happened in 1930-1940, and this was totally based on the social reform. And it is not that these movements or special groups, they always oppose the political parties. They don't have any kind of it's not always like that. These people, they talk to the political parties or the government. So they have a dialogue, they have a negotiation. So movement groups have raised new issues that have been taken up by the political parties. For example, this is a political party one, this is a political party two. Now this political party is in government, this political party is in opposition. So this political party which is in opposition, this is government, opposition will take the issues of the groups, various groups and pressure groups, etc., and try to pressurize the government if they find it better for to win the election. So sometimes political parties grow out of movement. If you see, all these are because of movements also. Now this important question comes is, how do you see this? Does these pressure groups and movements, they influence in a bad way? Are their influence unhealthy? First of all, it may appear that it's not healthy because they are actually pressurizing the government to meet their demands. But if they are doing it and it is available to everyone, that is, everyone can do that, it's not a bad thing. A democracy has strengthened because of these pressure groups. So pressure groups, if I can give you an example, governments can often come under pressure from small group of rich and powerful people. Okay, so they are, as I just said, Adani and Ambanis, they can put pressure on the government and the government can come under their pressure. But when we have the pressure groups and movements, government will think before doing anything which is against the normal citizen. So putting pressure on the ruler is not unhealthy activity in a democracy, as long as everyone gets this opportunity. Because whenever this kind of thing happens and pressure groups and movement happen, then the government has to see the needs and concerns of ordinary citizens. They can't just see these big people. I'm not saying that the government should not think of them because they are actually helping the economy. Then comes the public interest groups and movement perform a useful role in countering the influence and reminding the government that what are the needs and concerns of ordinary citizens, as we just saw. So if say one group, it is pressurizing the government, group one, it is pressurizing the government. Then there is another group which has to counter this. There may be another group. So there are different viewpoints that the government get. So the government gets to hear about what different sections of the population want. And this is only the democracy. When government thinks, understands, and listens to everyone, This is the democracy. So this is all about this chapter. Thank you so much. Take care of yourself.